Greetings. This is part 4 in a series. I recommend you watch parts 1 through 3 before viewing this installment. Evolution is not only a theory in crisis, it is a Ponzi scheme in collapse. The unending sequence of modifications and problems with the theory smack more of bad Islamic argumentation than of a so-called science. Evolutionary apologists use ad hominem attacks just like the dimwad dawa of Islam. The most common talking point you will hear in evolutionist polemics is the following.
Intelligent design is a religious concept cloaked in the language of science.
It arises from the fear of the oh-so-clear implication that evolution cannot work. If evolution cannot explain the existence of life, it means a creator must be considered by intellectually honest individuals. The reality is that intelligent design is identical to another acceptable pursuit, SETI, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. Scientists using science claim to be able to detect and determine intelligence, and don't laugh, in space aliens,
little green men.
Don't get me wrong, I'm not mocking their efforts. The very same science that makes SETI a scientific approach also makes intelligent design research a scientific approach. But the bias of anti-theists prevents them from recognizing this obvious truth. Science is supposed to be the approach used to investigate reality, objectively and with an honest pursuit of the truth, the reality we live in. Sort of like an even playing field in sports.
Sorry, but you have Christians on your team. The game starts at 2-0 against you.
But even with biased, dishonest efforts to suppress intellectually rigorous scientific investigation, for example, protein machines in the cell as detailed in Signature in the Cell by Dr. Stephen Meyer, and improbable and impossible coincidence of physical constants tuned to allow life, from The Privileged Planet by Gonzalez and Richards. They create an undeniable problem for the fantasy of abiogenesis and evolution to explain life on the Earth as we observe it. But if evolution could not happen, does that prove the 6 days of creation from Genesis? Not really, because there are several concepts mixed in that statement. As I said in the first video of this series, it is a false choice that you must either be an evolutionist or a young earther. While it is clear that godless evolution cannot have produced life as we see it, there is likewise simply too much physical evidence to think the Earth is only 6,000 years old. And that means neither option of our false choice is intellectually satisfying. And that is important if you dare to think God created the universe to be a sign. A sign that conveys clear and undeniable evidence of God, so that we are without excuse. Romans 1:20, for His invisible attributes, that is, His eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen since the creation of the world, being understood through what He has made. As a result, people are without excuse. I can understand the argument that only now do we have such clear knowledge. Perhaps only now is such irrefutable scientific knowledge required to convince the modern heart. At least irrefutable for those who honestly examine the issue. So what then is the answer to that dilemma? I think we must honestly examine both the physical evidence and the scriptures with unbiased eyes. I intend to examine the scripture portion of this equation. As always, be a good Berean. See if the things I quote are truly in the Bible. Then, honestly, whether my interpretation is plausible or even stronger than that. Jeremiah 4:23. I beheld the earth, and lo, it was without form and void, and the heavens, and they had no light. I beheld the mountains, and lo, they trembled, and all the hills moved lightly. I looked, and behold, there was no man, and all the birds of the heavens had fled. I looked, and behold, the fruitful land was a wilderness, and all its cities were pulled down before the Lord, before his fierce anger. Think about that passage again, focusing on the high points. I beheld the earth, and lo, it was without form and void, and all the birds of the heavens had fled, and all its cities were pulled down. If you need to, take a minute, pause the video, and go see for yourself this passage exists. When I first encountered it, I kind of went, hey, what the? Void? Birds? Men? You also must have this response if you recognize where else without form and void appears. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. 1:2. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Same exact words. Prophet Jeremiah speaks of men, birds, and cities before the earth became without form and void. Prophet Jeremiah speaks of men, birds, and cities before the situation described in Genesis 1:2. Look at one more similarity. It was without form and void, and the heavens, and they had no light. Genesis 1:2, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. The lights in the heavens were dark as well. You can see in both verses. That makes me think these two passages refer to the same situation or configuration. Let me draw you a picture. It was without form and void, and the heavens, and they had no light. So at some time, the earth was without form, void, and the heavens were dark. I beheld, and lo, there was no man, and all the birds of the heavens were fled. There were no men, the birds had fled. This phrase, there was no man, is interesting. You can try to read it as no men yet, but you'll see why that does not fit in a moment. All the birds of the heavens were fled. All the birds were fled clearly means there were birds. There were birds before the earth was without form and void. So before the earth was without form and void, at some prior time, there were men and birds. I looked, and behold, the fruitful land was a wilderness, and all its cities were pulled down before the Lord, before his fierce anger. I looked, and behold, the fruitful land. Fruitful speaks of cultivation, crops, harvest, and all its cities were pulled down. It had cities. Can you see why no men yet does not work? Cities implies men who made the cities. So there were cities of men before the earth was without form and void. So Jeremiah writes of birds, cities, and men before the void earth. For thus says the Lord, the whole land shall be a desolation, yet I will not execute a complete destruction. The destruction will not be complete. If you think this is the end of it all, you have to explain this. In the end of it all, the destruction is complete. We get a new earth. You may want to propose that this is Noah's flood. I certainly understand the inclination to do so, except for this. And the heavens, they had no light. This seems to indicate no stars, no moon, no sun. I don't recall that as part of the story of Noah, so I'd hesitate to base my interpretation on that. Let me draw you another picture. Genesis 1:2, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. So at some time, the earth was without form and void, and it was dark. This is what we consider the beginning. Well, not exactly. Before Genesis 1:2, and the earth being without form and void, and dark, there was Genesis 1:1, which is the real start, at some prior time. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So at some prior time was the real start in Genesis 1:1. So Genesis 1:1 and 1:2 leave us with this picture. The start in Genesis 1:1, and in Genesis 1:2, the earth is without form, void, and dark at some time later. And when you attempt to harmonize that with Jeremiah 4:23 through 27, you get the following. There were birds and men and cities in between Genesis 1:1 and 1:2. Because before Genesis 1:2, before the earth was without form and void and dark, Jeremiah documents cities of men, birds that were gone, a fruitful land that had become a wilderness. So why is that an important distinction to identify and explain? Well, the Bible never says the earth is 6,000 years old. But there are reasonable attempts at scholarship which lend themselves to that thought. First, the ages of the men in the Bible got added up, and given the record, it accumulated to 6,000-ish. I just find it weak to claim that we can know to the day when any events happened 6,000 years ago. A possible exception are eclipses, if you believe God has not changed the orbital dynamics since creation. The ephemeris of the solar system are well determined at this point and run both forward and backwards. This is how eclipses may be calculated, down to the latitudes, longitudes, time zones, and durations that will observe it. This is how stellarium may show the sign of Revelation 12:1 on September 23rd, 2017. So unless a date 5,983 years ago were tied to an eclipse, I question claims of specific dates. Second, 1,000 years is as a day to the Lord, gets linked to 6 days of creation proving 6,000 years. Don't misunderstand. I believe the week, the concept of seven, is a very strong type. The Shabbat, or seventh day, maps nicely to the millennium. And I really do believe man has been around 6,000 years since Genesis 1:2. However, I think there is a huge gap between the beginning, the Big Bang of Genesis 1:1, and the big reboot, the clean restart of Genesis 1:2. And I am willing to entertain the idea that punctuated equilibrium happened over the time before Genesis 1:2. Why am I willing to think that? Stay with me and I'll explain. I can just imagine you might be thinking, Texas has gone nuts. Think about creation by God with God's Legos. In the beginning, God created space-time and the laws of physics. Have you ever made bread? It's not like cookies. It's not stir, mix, and bake. You mix the ingredients, and then you wait. You have to let some part of the process take its natural course. But the natural course means obeying the laws of physics. Across the time the process takes, while staying within the laws of physics. With bread, you have to let the yeast rise. Well, what if the laws of physics that allow life to exist in a form that spirit can occupy is so fragile it took iterations to develop the self-propagating, self-sustaining process? Believe me, I can hear the reaction. You mean God couldn't just speak yada 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 and make it so? Put your boots on, because this is going to get deep in a hurry. God can speak, and His word is power. More powerful than 1,000 lightning bolts. But lightning bolts are destructive because they are uncontrolled. What I seek to know is the process by which God's power created strings and space-time and DNA. It was His infinite power, as we even understand power, controlled by His infinite intelligence. What if the laws of physics required time for protein machines and DNA programs to stabilize? What if God knew the natural process He chose to use would eventually produce the result He desired? Natural, material, flesh, capable of holding created spirit. Take that one step further. Natural, material, flesh, capable of holding His own Son's eternal spirit. When I consider the works of your hands, O God, I shake and tremble in awe and amazement. I do not want to dismiss in a sanctimonious and disrespectful way the complexity and miracle of creation accomplished by God. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.